I've got a script I'm supposed to follow, so.
Well, but hold on, John, you're just picking up.
All right. Cindy Cummings.
Well, I think I'm supposed to introduce you, but that's okay.
Cindy Cummings is the founder of Senior Resource Alliance. Take it away, Cindy.
Thank you, John. Good morning. My name is Cindy Cummings, and I'm the founder of the Austin Senior Resource Alliance. And we're a group of businesses who've come together to help seniors and their families through becoming a senior. It's kind of complex. So part of our alliance includes many different types of businesses, and one of the businesses is John. And he is a specialist in probate. And so he's here to talk about probate, and we're excited to have him. Last month, we had a talk here on how to live to 100. And we didn't have a huge turnout. This is a better turnout, but that was an exceptionally awesome, awesome seminar. And I hope that we can return and do that seminar again. Next month, we're gonna be having a seminar on, let me read about it. It is on decluttering your home and the psychological issues that come about when your home is cluttered. Also, there's safety issues that have to do when your home is cluttered. So that's going to be our talk next month. Our talks begin at 10:30, and it will be on March 27th. In April, our speaker is going to be talking about directives and how important directives are. And he actually will start you on the process of getting your directives together, and how to have conversations such as what your wishes are with your family. Because a lot of times your family doesn't know what you want, and it gets into issues when that time comes about. So that's going to be our April talk, so we're excited about that. What's that?
What day?
It's normally, is it the third? Is it the fourth?
It's the last.
Last Tuesday of the month. Yes, last Tuesday of the month, if that helps. So, and we have some other really great topics as the year progresses. But today we do have John. He is an attorney. He's an attorney from Florida and from the state of Texas. And his specialty has been working with people in talking about probate, setting up trusts, how probates work, et cetera. So we're really excited to have him here today. We actually are gonna have kind of a question and answer. I'm gonna interview him. And as you can see, he's going to be on TV, which he's very excited about. Right, John? He has such a stoic look. You have to get him to smile. He actually has been on CBS, and he's been on TV how many times now?
Every month.
For about a year?
About 2 years.
So he's getting pretty good at this question answer. But what's great about being in a live environment like this is we'll go through the questions that we have, and then at the end, there'll be time for you to ask your questions too. And that's the part that we love. So I'm just gonna get started. Like I said, it's kind of a question answer at the beginning, and then we would welcome any of your questions. So we'll go ahead and get started.
Thank you, Cindy.
Yes, John, would you like to do any more introduction about yourself that I might have?
I suppose not.
Suppose not?
You have to forgive my voice. The lecturing over the years has taken its toll. Cindy said I'm a probate attorney. I'm not. I don't go to court anymore. And my function is to keep you out of court, too. If the talk had a subject title, it would be How to Avoid Probate. Probate is voluntary. What is probate? Anybody tell me? Yes. It's interesting that you said that. The lady said it's when people die without a will and you have to go to court. That's not what probate is. That's part of what probate is. But somebody out there said to me earlier this morning, well, I don't have to go to probate. I have a will. Wills go through probate. Probate is the court-administered distribution of the assets of somebody who has a will. So if you don't have a will, that's called intestacy. And what would happen in that case is you go into court, somebody would go into court, a relative probably, And somebody would be appointed the executor. And what would happen is the statute in the state of Texas would determine who gets the assets. I'll tell you about a case that I had in Florida. This fellow was a firefighter. He was a Canadian who had moved to the United States. And he was referred to me by a real estate broker who said the guy was going to close a couple of industrial buildings. He was very frugal with his money and bought little industrial buildings. So I handled those for him, and then I asked him, do you have estate documents? And he said, well, sort of. So I took him into the office, and we went through the attorney-client questionnaire. And when I got to the point where I asked him who his heirs would be, he said, I'm going on vacation tomorrow. I'll be back in a couple of weeks. I'll call you. He didn't. And I don't call anybody that expresses some interest. They need to call me and make an appointment. Cindy's taken all your names, and how to get in hold with you. You won't get a call from me. He didn't call. And a couple years later, the broker called and said that he had been killed in a motorcycle accident against a tree at 3 o'clock in the morning. And would I handle the estate? I said, okay. He said there was a will, and he brought the will in. It was a handwritten will. Handwritten wills can be okay, provided they have certain aspects of them that the court will allow. In this case, not only wasn't it a Florida will, it wasn't even a United States will. He did it in the firehouse in Canada at midnight. There were no witnesses. The court threw it out. That's intestacy. Now, this fella had a mother and a father and siblings, no wife, no children. The statute in Florida, as it does here, says first your parents, then your siblings, if you don't have a wife and children. He loved his mother, hated his father. His father left early, treated the wife badly, the mother. But the father ended up getting half his estate. And that is exactly what he did not want, I'm sure, based on everything I was told. So that's an intestacy. Half the people in this country don't even have a will, according to the statistics that I've read. That's intestacy. But if you have a will, you go into probate court. In order to go in probate court, you must have an attorney, unless it's a very small estate. $75,000 in assets or less, then you can do a self-probate. Attorneys cost a few hundred dollars an hour. Filing fees are a few hundred dollars. A probate takes a minimum of 3 to 6 months and usually much longer. Somebody told me theirs was 4 years. Probate can be attacked. A will can be attacked. By a relative or anybody who thinks they ought to have been an heir. Trusts are private. Nobody gets to see the trust unless you want them to. And if they're not named in the trust, they don't get to see it anyway. What's a trust? A trust is a 20-page document, and about 17 of those pages talk about the fact that you can do exactly with a trust what you could do without one. The rest of it acts just like a will. Who gets what and when? There are three parties to a trust. There's the grantor, or the settlor, who retitles their assets to the trust. How do they do that? They go to the bank and they change the signature card on their checking account or their savings account, or both, from their name, John Levy, to the John Levy Revocable Trust. Now the trust owns those accounts, not me. I may own the trust, but the trust owns the accounts. They call their stockbroker and change the name of their stock accounts that are not retirement accounts to the trust. Now all those stock accounts are in the trust. The IRAs and 401ks, the deferred income accounts, they do not change the ownership. That would cause a taxable event. They change the beneficiary. And I would advise anybody to talk to their financial advisor as to which of two choices they might find most beneficial. One is to make the trust the beneficiary. That's handy because when you talk about who gets what, typically that article in the trust can get complicated. I leave my estate to my living children, per stirpes, or their descendants. But what if one of them dies without descendants? Well, then we have other things that we do. And it goes on and on from there. So it's either the trust is the beneficiary or name people. It's up to the financial advisor to advise you which is better for you. So, and the real estate, you have the attorney prepare a deed from you to you as trustee of your trust. Now, the trust owns everything. Or in the case of the stocks, the beneficiary. And by the way, there's a lot of reasons not to make a beneficiary on a checking account or things like that. There's about 25 or 30 reasons. And if you give me your name and email, I'll email you those reasons. Why doesn't there be a need for probate? Because trusts don't die. People die. But if everything's titled to the trust, and probate is the court-administered distribution of the assets of people, there's no need for probate. So what happens? The successor trustee who you choose pays last medical, any debts, funeral, and distributes the money. It's that simple, folks. You avoid probate. And that's my whole deal in what I thought was going to be semi-retirement. It's turned out to be something else because with television and the Austin Senior Guide and the guide that Cindy's going to put out, there are explanations as to all of this, and my plate is full, but I enjoy it. I don't play golf. I live on Jack Nicklaus Drive, but I do not play golf. The golf cart is to take the dog around in the evening, in the summer when it gets hot. So that's what a trust is. Are there any questions about that? Anybody have a trust? Good.
So when the person passes away, does the trust go away then?
No, the trust stays. So you can leave your assets in stages. Say you have children. They may be minor children. They may be adult children who act like minor children. You can leave money to them in stages so they don't blow the whole wad all at once. Often I see folks saying, well, you got to be 25 years old and then you can have 25% of your share. When you reach the age of, you fill in the blank, maybe you get 25% of the then balance of the account. And you may have another stage or you may give them the balance at a third stage, up to you. This avoids what I call a starter marriage, bad business advice from a friend, a scam. Did you know that in Travis County, anybody can go down and look at the probate file, see who gets it and when? It's even on the internet. So that's another advantage of trust. They're private. Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry, I was late, so you may have already covered this. dollar amount of which a trust is preferable?
I have done trusts for people with $150,000 in assets. There are attorneys who would argue that this is overkill, but I charge $575 for a trust. They probably charge that for a will, especially if it's a couple. So it's not an unnecessary expense. It's an important expense. Yes?
Would it be different in a different state, what you're talking about, the trust, or is this?
Trusts are ambulatory. You can take it to any state that you move to. And if you have a will and you move out of state, the general rule in almost all states is if the will is executed with the proper formalities in that state in which it was executed, it will be honored in your new state. So you probably don't need a new will if you move to another state. Yes?
So if, let's say, I have some, you know, bank accounts or stocks, whatever it is, and they're in a trust, but a house which is in my name is in my will.
You should transfer the property from you to you if you're your own trustee, as trustee of the trust.
Okay.
Now the trust will own it. You keep your homestead exemption. It's a grantor trust. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Is there any guidelines on when do you set up a trust?
Now.
Okay, still a student.
As soon as you have documents. Not long ago, I prepared documents for a client, and they died before they could come back and sign them. There's no contract on tomorrow for any of us. You appear to be one of the younger folks in here. You bring down the average age significantly. But I do them primarily for seniors because that's what my semi-retirement is all about. It's providing services to seniors at a low cost. Yes, sir?
This trust is like a different legal entity, right?
It's not. It's not a separate legal person. It's a different legal entity. But it's not like a corporation which shields you against creditors.
I was just wondering about taxes. Does
your own Social Security number. It doesn't even file a tax return.
It doesn't.
Everything flows through to your own 1040.
John, can we just go through the process of if you didn't have a will, what would happen in the court? Could you do that? If you did have a will, what would happen in the court?
The same thing. The same thing.
So just start
with a trust, you don't go to court at all.
Okay. So if I don't have a will and I die, what happens?
The court will look at the statute and determine whether your parents get the money. If you have no husband or children, if you have a husband and children, they would get it. If you don't have a husband and children, then your parents would get it. And if you have no parents, then your siblings. And if there's no siblings, then they go to the next generation of relatives, I suppose, first cousins probably. Yes?
Goes to when it was put into the trust as opposed to when the person dies.
That's not my information. My information is that the cost basis stays the same because it's the same. The trust isn't a separate entity.
The cost basis is the same as what?
As it was when you had it in your personal name. Now, you can check this because I have not had that come up. But what she's talking about is the adjusted cost basis at date of death. Under the tax laws, it's constituted now. If I bought a share of General Motors for a dollar a long time ago, and now it's worth $1,000, the IRS treats that as though I bought the stock the day I died at that basis, $1,000. It's even better than that. There's something called an adjusted basis 6 months after stated date of death, and you get to choose which one. You don't, but your successor does. Therefore, it's a real benefit that the IRS gives you. Now, what this lady is suggesting is by transferring it to your trust, it's now a new owner. Well, in name it is, but in actuality, if you look at what the counties do with regard to a trust when you transfer your real estate, your home, to the trust, you keep your homestead exemption because it's you. And I have not heard that that would not be true of your stocks and bonds as well, but it's something that I will research and probably you should too.
Yeah, we just had that. We were surprised.
Who told you that?
The finance group that transferred the stocks out of the trust into, you know, our finance group.
It's worth taking a look at.
Okay.
Yes.
So if I put my house in the trust now, mm-hmm. and the trust owns it, so do I have to notify the county?
Or? No, I notify the county. I prepare a deed which you sign, deeding it from you to you as trustee of your trust. The county's notified because I've sent them a deed and they record it.
His process for
but,
you.
But my, for tax, for property tax and everything, anything changes or they just.
Keep your homestead exemption.
They just send it to me personally?
Yeah.
Okay.
As trustee.
Okay.
So then you're saying the trust has a different tax return?
No, it does not. It doesn't file a tax return. He's talking about real estate taxes. Yes.
So I didn't finish my question. So if you set up a trust, does all your asset goes into the trust, or do you have control of a certain portion of it?
You have control of it in the trust. You don't even need a new checking account. Just change the signature card. Everything stays the same. Nothing happens until you die, or in a married couple situation, until the last of the couple passes. Yes, sir?
Just a slight correction, disagreement. I was trustee for my parents' trust after they died. We filed tax returns on that trust for several years.
That's after you die.
After
that's different. Once you die, the trust does file a tax return unless all the assets are dispersed immediately. But if the trust is ongoing, yes, the trust would file a tax return because you're no longer filing a 1040. You're gone. Okay? Yes?
Now, for a checking account, okay, we have it like a common checking account.
A joint account.
Mm-hmm. So do I need to do anything about that?
Is it a joint trust that you're contemplating? Or
no,
separate?
It's my trust.
Not you and your wife?
No, in the trust. No, she's a beneficiary, but
it's your trust.
It's my trust.
All right, well, and if she's to write checks on the trust account, she needs to be a trustee, a co-trustee. If she's not going to be a co-trustee, then you want to keep a separate account for expenses that both of you are on.
That's what I mean, it's joint.
Have a second account, but an account with a lot of money in it, no, put it in the trust.
But now, right now, we have a joint account. So if I die, it still hurts, right?
Yeah.
Automatically. I mean, she doesn't have to do anything.
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So if I understand it, you set up one trust once with a trust document. Then every time you open up, say, a new CD somewhere, or which can happen once a year or more frequently,
put it in the name of the trust.
So the trust has its own designation name in the trust document, and it's always going to be referred to.
That's right. A trust is amendable. If circumstances change, you can amend the trust. Change of trustee, change of beneficiary. One of your beneficiaries mouths off to you, you can write them out. But that said, I don't mention any assets in the trust unless you want me to. In other words, stock brokerage account number 457 goes to this person. Then I might mention an asset. Otherwise, I don't. And it's very rare that I would mention any specific asset. You do go about your business just like you do now.
So the trust document will refer to all the assets unless it's mentioned.
Yes.
Okay. And every account has to mention the trust.
The name of the account is the John Jones Revocable Trust. Yeah. Yes, sir.
When a person passes, would you transfer assets out of their trust into the beneficiaries?
Is that your wish?
Or would it be better to change the ownership of that trust? Or can you do that?
You've hit on a subject that I don't talk about. I send people to their financial advisor, and I've talked about it to you a moment ago, retirement accounts. You can transfer a retirement account to somebody and they don't have to take the money out and they can keep accumulating tax deferred. Now, some people want to do that, some people don't. I leave that to the tax advisor. If you want to leave money in stages to heirs, the trust goes on. You don't have to change anything. It's still your trust. You're gone. There's a successor trustee that you named, and you can put two or three alternates in line successively, and the trust goes on to handle the money. But you don't have to wrap it up and give everything away right away, no. Yes. Did you have your hand up? No. Yes.
Yeah, sorry. So if you have like some kind of an asset or an IRA or something, and it's you have a pay on death to or whatever it is, what the term is.
Well, there's a beneficiary form on your IRA.
Okay.
And again, you have two choices. You can make the trust the beneficiary, or you can make individuals the beneficiary. Talk to your financial advisor.
What happens then? Does it have to go to court too, or is it automatic? That's automatic then if it's
anything with a beneficiary doesn't go to court.
Doesn't go to court?
No.
Okay.
But when bank accounts have beneficiaries, there's all kinds of problems, and that's what I want you to get in touch with me for so I can, well, I'll read to you. I think I got it on here. You don't have to call me. I think it's in my archive, way back when.
Can you talk while you're looking?
No.
Okay.
I have trouble talking when I'm chewing gum. Apparently I've erased it. Get in touch with me, I'll send you the list. It's everything from the co-owner of the account to have an accident beyond insurance limits. They may be gone, and the person that you wanted to get the asset doesn't get it. Things like that, but send me the information, I'll send it back to you. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question about trustee. So if you have minor children and you don't have somebody that you can name as a trustee, like after you're gone, then what are your options?
It's wide open. A friend, a longtime trusted friend, a relative, a trust company, but they're expensive. Yeah, you gotta pay them. But lots of ways to do that. Some lawyers, I suppose, would do that. I don't. None of you have known me long enough to make me the trustee of your estate. And most lawyers should give you the very same answer, unless you've known them all your life.
John, do you have to have an attorney to go through probate?
Absolutely. You must have a lawyer to go into probate court unless your estate is less than $75,000. Then you can do a self-probate. But that's no fun either.
Is there a probate system? Well, I guess if you had more than $75,000, you should be able to afford an attorney. I guess that's the reality. If you go that direction.
It's not like a criminal where you have the right to an attorney. If you don't have one, one will be appointed for you. In civil cases, that's not the case. Yeah. Yes?
So I have two generations of questions. One is, my mother passed away, there were assets in her name, and they went into the trust, and...
They went into the trust through probate.
Yes. And then my father has assets in his name, and the direction he's been given is he should spend his own money, and the trust is still there, and if he dies before he needs to go use the money that's in the trust, then that is going to go to his children.
Okay.
But the trust is an entity that has assets in it, has to pay taxes, and has its
Once somebody dies, the trust then does have a tax ID number and does file a tax return. But in, while one of the grantors is still alive and the Social Security number is still functioning, it flows through to that Social Security number.
So then in my own situation, my husband and I made a will, and the will has in it the family trust, but I didn't think it existed until one of us passed away. But I think you're saying that
the will has in it the family trust. What
well, it refers to it.
How does, what does it talk about?
Well, I don't remember the specifics, but I assume that it meant...
I suppose you could...
We probably have a document that creates the trust, and then the will says...
I don't think the, I don't see how a will can leave a trust to somebody because the trust has its own terms. It would have to leave the asset to somebody, and that somebody could then deal with those assets. But I don't think you can leave a trust to somebody because a trust is a very personal document. I'd love to see those documents to
well,
see.
Well, I'm not understanding the right procedure then.
It may be, yes.
So if you have a will, but then you decide to set up a trust, then your will is pretty much null and void.
Yeah.
You rip it up.
Oh, good question. You get another will, and it's free, which brings up another topic. When I do a trust, it's 575. You should also have some other documents. All of you should have a durable power of attorney. You may not know this, but if you have a power of attorney, it's void if one becomes mentally incapacitated through a stroke, a coma, Alzheimer's. In that case, somebody would have to go into probate court, guardianship division, and be appointed your legal guardian. That means lawyers, that means a few hundred dollars an hour, it means quarterly accountings and inventories for the judge. We have a way around guardianship, and it's called a durable power of attorney. It's durable, it's strong, and it transcends mental incapacity. And with that, banks, stockbrokers, title companies have to honor a durable power of attorney. I charge $150 for a durable power of attorney. All of you should have one. The other documents I prepare free. One is a pour-over will, which you're talking about. A pour-over will says, if I forgot to title one of my assets to the trust, I leave it to the trust. It pours over. Now, that one thing would have to go through probate, so you don't really want to miss transferring your accounts, your dollar-denominated accounts to the trust. But also, the pour-over will has a paragraph that says, I may leave a list. I might want to leave a piece of jewelry to this person or my gun collection to that person or a piece of furniture to somebody. I'll put down the name, the item, I'll sign the list, I'll date it. Representative, if you find such a list within 30 days, honor the list. If you don't find such a list within 30 days, there is no list. That's the pour-over will that you get. It's a companion document to the trust. The other documents which you all should have are health care documents. There's three of them, and I combine them all into one. It's 8 pages long. But I'm not going to talk any more about that because Cindy's got somebody who's going to spend a whole morning talking about that, okay? Other questions? Yes?
Would you please define revocable trust?
A revocable trust?
Irrevocable?
Yeah, well, an irrevocable trust is just that. Once it's signed, it cannot be changed. You can't take property out of it. You can't put property into it. And the heirs have to stay the same and the trustees stay the same. Unless, of course, somebody dies. A revocable trust, you can revoke it by emptying it. If you take the properties that you put into the trust and change the name back to your own name and do it with all the properties, then it's a naked trust and it's a nullity.
You can nullify by changing the name back to the personal.
More questions? I can't think of one. I am asked that by many people, not everybody, but I cannot think of a negative to having a trust. And I prepare about 200 of them a year.
If you have a bank account and it has named beneficiaries and you set up a trust, does the bank account's documents override the trust or not?
It overrides the trust. That's what Princess Di did, some of that stuff. You know, you put some, the Article 3 of the trust is fairly detailed. I leave my estate to this person, that person, this person. But if they die and they don't have children, or you didn't leave it to their children, then what? The beneficiary form at the bank probably doesn't provide for that. Then you got to go down to who's next, and if they're not around, who's after that? I don't like beneficiary forms on bank accounts, and payable on death accounts. Again, send me your information and I'll send you 25 or 30 reasons not to do that. Yes, sir.
In Texas, they now have what's called transfer on death.
That's right, the transfer on death deed for real estate. And that's fine, I do those. And you can do that for people who don't want a trust or don't have enough to have a trust, but they have a house. We do a transfer on death deed, which names beneficiaries on the deed. I've done those too.
Do you need that for a spouse or no?
How's the property owned?
Both spouses. So you wouldn't do it?
No.
Yeah.
It's joint.
Ladybird Trust?
A Ladybird Trust is an enhanced life estate. That's different. It's not a Ladybird Trust, it's a Ladybird deed. You can deed your property to somebody else while keeping control of the property yourself. You can sell it, you can finance it, but when you die, it goes to that person, and the deed is already, it's very much like a transfer on death deed. Yes? Oh, no. You could put in fact, if you think about it, originally trusts were for the very wealthy. If you go to Newport Beach and you go to some of these mansions, the Rockefellers and all those folks, they had family trusts. And it was only for the wealthy. But trusts now are the will substitute of our generation, and anybody can have one. The whole idea is to keep attorneys and courts out of the equation. That's what I'm trying to do. And a guy by the name of Dacey, maybe in the 50s, wrote a book, How to Avoid Probate. Maybe some of you read it back then. And there have been other books, How to Avoid Probate, since then. But I didn't write a book. I'm telling you what the book says. It says the revocable trust. Yes?
So, how would you define a bypass trust?
You don't need it anymore. The bypass trust is a function of years ago when the estate tax, now we're talking about estate tax, not income tax, the estate tax exemption was $600,000 per person. But if you left everything to your wife, and you had $600,000, and she had $600,000. Now she's got $1,200,000, and $600,000 of that would be taxed. So,
only when she dies.
Pardon?
Only when she dies, not when she receives.
Well, that's right. But now, the estate tax exemption is $5.4 million for each of you. And the first $5.4 million, when one person dies, is transferred over to the spouse. So the spouse now has almost an $11 million exemption. So you don't need an AB trust. An AB trust said, when one of us dies, a second trust will be set up. One will be the family trust, which it is now, and everything else over and above that $600,000, or today I guess it would be $5.4 million, would go into the survivor trust. And that could go up to $5.4 million and still have no estate tax. So we don't do AB trusts or Q-tip trusts anymore.
Those
are
synonymous terms.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good question. Yes?
So I think you mentioned about the list for specific people. Does that have to be part of the will?
Say again?
You made a list for individual jewelry or whatever.
No, it's incorporated in the will by reference. We talk about it in Article 7, but it's a separate sheet of paper, and you don't have to redo your documents in order to keep changing it. Just tear it up and do another one anytime you want.
But does it have to have witnesses?
No.
Just sign?
Nope. No witnesses, no notaries. Yes.
Can this trust be challenged, like you left everything to one person?
It's a lot harder to challenge a trust than it is a will. It's harder to challenge a trust than it is a will. Wills are available for everybody to see there in court. Nobody gets to see the trust unless they're mentioned in it. Now, you might sue, somebody might sue to break a trust, but it's much harder than it is to attack a will, and much more likely, less likely to be attacked. One way to avoid such an attack is, if you have enough money, leave enough in there for the person who you expect to attack it and put in an in terrorem clause. An in terrorem clause says, if anybody objects through court action to anything in this document, it will be as if they were not mentioned in the document in the first place and they will get nothing. That's handy. Yes, sir. Ma'am.
The only reason I'm thinking about this trust is a friend of mine whose family did this for their mom's house because they knew that they were going to have to put their mom in a home, and they wanted to shield that from Medicare, Medicaid.
I don't get involved with Medicaid. There are people who do, and if you're interested in Medicaid, that's where the government pays for your nursing home and your medical. There are restrictions on that. I don't get involved on that, but if you see me privately, I'll give you the name of somebody to call, and they're an expert. Anybody else?
I just have a question. So, because redid my wills, and so my husband had to have a will, and I have to have a will. Basically, it says same thing up until a few layers down. But on a trust, can it be a joint trust?
It is a joint trust often.
Yeah,
most,
okay.
Most often. Nothing happens until the last of you is gone.
Okay.
And by the way, I do wills free for seniors. So if somebody just wants a will and healthcare documents, free. That's what the Senior Resource Alliance is about. Yeah.
So if you have either will or trust, if you change your physical assets, say you move to another house, or you get a car, and everything.
The car isn't part of the trust. You just go to the tag agency if somebody dies. But no, you move to Alaska. The person who signed it with the address in there, they can track down that was you. You don't have to, every time you move. Some people are in the military. They'd have to change their documents every month.
But what if they have property? Don't they need to redo the deed? They have real property. They bought property in Alaska.
If you buy a property, you take title in the name of the trust.
Right.
Yeah.
So you would have to have the deed of the property in
here. Oh, by the way, anybody have real estate outside of Texas? Two probates. One in the other state where you have real estate, and one here. But if the out-of-state properties are titled to the trust, no probate at all. Glad I thought of that one. Yeah?
So if you have all your assets over in the trust, and somebody decides that you do something wrong, you get sued, does the trust protect you against that, or can they?
No, that's not what it's for. It's not a separate legal person. It's to avoid lawyers and courts and probate. That is the reason for a trust, not to avoid creditors.
Okay.
On the other hand, pardon? A judgment creditor or any creditor. However, there's language in the document that says no heir, the money in the trust cannot be attached by a creditor of an heir once I pass. So if the money stays in trust, the creditor can't get at it. So that is a protection against a creditor, but not the grantor's creditor, the beneficiary's creditor. Yes?
Your primary residence is asset protected, correct?
Up to a point. There's a homestead exemption. Do you know the homestead exemption in Texas?
What do you mean as far as?
Creditors.
I don't think they can take your homestead.
Well, they can if it's expensive enough in some states. Let's see what it is. Texas homestead exemption. Your share of the, well, it depends on what it says. If it's a family limited partnership, but everybody has their own share, and it doesn't revert automatically to other members of the family, you change your share to your trust. If it's a joint tenancy kind of thing where everybody, it stays within those people, then you can't. Let me answer that question about the Texas homestead exemption.
And John looked at me because I am a real estate agent. He's thinking I should know that. So thank you, John, for putting that up.
There is no reason you should know that. Bankruptcy attorneys should know that. Protection. Texas homestead protection. Protects qualifying real property from forced sale by general creditors, and courts have interpreted the law broadly to help accomplish their goals. A homestead can be either an urban property or rural property. There is no limit to the value of urban or rural homesteads, only to their size. Okay. Unlimited exemption. Anybody remember who Bowie Kuhn was? Any baseball fans? He was the commissioner of Major League Baseball. He was also the partner of a major law firm in New York. The law firm went broke, and so did the individuals for some reason. But before they did, he went down to Florida and bought a multi-million dollar home, exempt from creditors. A lot of people do that in Florida because there's no limit. Apparently, there's no limit in Texas either. So. If you get sued, go buy the biggest house you can afford, and creditors can't get at it. Unless, of course, they show that you did that in order to delay or defraud creditors. That's bankruptcy business and not mine. Yes?
So you're talking about trusts and wills, and if you had a trust that you would really need a will, would a will...
The will is a pour-over will. It's free. It's a companion document to the trust.
But you would use a will to direct guardians for your children?
Yes.
Are there any other things
you have minor children, you can't leave your children to somebody in a trust, but you can nominate, you can not, I know some of you would like to. You can nominate a guardian for a minor child in your will. It is my strong preference, strong language needed, that so-and-so be the legal guardian for so-and-so and so-and-so. Yeah.
And then once they're 18, that's not needed anymore?
If they are emancipated at 18, yes. Yes?
So the trust has a trustee and a beneficiary.
It has a grantor who puts their property into the trust. Okay. It has a trustee who watches over the assets. And a beneficiary, and then initially you're all three.
But, okay, so if I die...
The successor trustee who you appointed takes over.
Can that trustee change or take anything out of it?
Not. They have to follow, it's a fiduciary duty to follow your instructions in that trust. That would be a crime to
Okay.
Take money and give it to somebody else.
But the beneficiary then can take assets out.
The beneficiary can't. The trustee does it in accordance with what the trust says. If the trust says the beneficiary gets it right away, then they get it right away.
Okay.
But if it says they get it 5 years from now, they can't have it until 5 years from now, except for two things. I usually put language in that says except for uninsured medical expenses and educational expenses, including room, board, and tuition. Okay.
So, I mean, if I'm the trustee and I'm everything, once I die, do I need, I mean, can I then make my wife the trustee and the beneficiary?
Yes.
At the same time?
Yes.
Okay.
So
yes, sir.
You need to think through, again, in case the successor trustee will want to serve as a trustee, who would
if they cannot or will not serve, I take my clients through all of that at our first meeting.
So that there's a whole...
Oh, yeah, you're protected against that kind of thing happening, sure.
And then
yes.
With mental incapacity, so when, like initially, the grantor, the trustee, the beneficiary, would be me. And then if, let's say, my son then is the beneficiary, at what point does he become trustee of the trust if I become mentally incapacitated? How does that...
The trustee language says that you are the trustee at such time as you cannot or will not serve, and mentally incapacity. And there's language in the trust that talks about what is mental incapacity. Then he would take over. Yes?
A lawyer told me if you put a ladybird deed in the property, then you don't have to go through a probate court.
That's right.
It's just not just for the property.
Yeah, it's like a payable on death deed. It's or it's like an enhanced estate.
But the rest of the assets would have to go through property.
Oh, yeah, the rest would have to go through probate, sure.
On a personal basis, I do have a trust, as I said. Would you take me as a client if I wanted to come and maybe have you look at it and change?
That's called a trust amendment.
Okay.
We can do an amendment or we can do a restated and amended trust. That's 475.
Okay.
$475. Right, it's $100 less. The formalities are the same. You're still going to come back to me with two witnesses and a notary watching each other watch you sign. That's a self-proving signature.
John, do you know the difference of selling property if you're going through probate versus if you're selling the property that was in a trust? How would that be
like? If you're selling property that's in a trust, there is no probate. If you're selling property that and you're in probate, it's conceivable that you would have to get the court's permission in order to sell it, especially if there's a dispute among heirs. The spouse says it's worth $400,000. All the houses in our neighborhood are worth $400,000. But the kid says, I think it's worth $600,000. Well, now you got an issue for the court. And the executor is going to have to get court approval to sell it in order not to take on the chance that they could be wrong and proved wrong later on and, you know, that kind of thing.
So there's a cost associated with that, and then there's also the time period in which you have to wait. If you wanted to sell a property that was part of a trust, you can just do it. And
yeah, just sell it. Right.
Stories.
I got one. Happened a couple months ago. Couple, seven-figure net worth, elderly, adult children. And we got to the point where I asked them who their beneficiary is. Three blind cat sanctuaries. Not just cat sanctuaries, blind cat sanctuaries. One of them is called the cat house. I said, why is this? Well, our kids borrowed money from us once and never tried to pay it back. And they remembered that, and it bothered them their whole lives. Pretty expensive loans, hey? Yeah, I have a true story, a true lawyer story. It won the prize as best true story of the year. It should have won the best true story ever. This lawyer bought a box of very expensive cigars and insured them against calamity. And before he made the first premium payment, he filed a claim stating that these cigars had been burned in a series of small fires. The attorney for the insurance company knew this was ridiculous, and the judge knew this was ridiculous, but they paid the claim because this guy was going to appeal it all the way up to the state Supreme Court. As soon as he cashed the check, they had him arrested for arson. He did 3 years and paid a $25,000 fine. There is justice in the world.
So we have to leave. How do I contact you?
Here is information, and here is what is probate. Mine.
And I'll pass all this around. You have some more questions.
Oh.
Thank you very much.
You're most welcome. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Or people. Let your financial advisor answer that one. That's not for me to answer.
So if we did not do that.
If you did not do what?
List the trust.
Name people. No.
Yeah, okay. So go straight to
that. Yeah, anything with a beneficiary doesn't go through probate. Everything. No, I wouldn't be talking about this if you had to go through probate and you still had a trust.
Can you repeat the question?
The question was, does a trust only protect the real estate from probate? And the answer is no. It protects all of your assets. Other questions? Yes?
Basic question. In the trust, you don't have to list all the assets.
You don't list any assets. No. Percentages. I leave X percent to this person and this X percent, because you don't know how much money there's going to be.
Yeah.
Now, if you want to leave a certain thing to a certain person, you can do that. But it's best to do that with a list.
But within the bank account, you have beneficiaries and you have different percentages.
Call me and I will send you reasons why not to do that. Folks, you can leave. If people still have questions, they can come up here. I don't want you to feel captive. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you so much. We hope to see you next month.